The following is a local resident producers program. The program content is the sole responsibility of the producer and does not necessarily reflect the views or policies of CATV2, Oshkosh Community Media Services, the City of Oshkosh, or Time Warner Cable.
Everybody, Cheryl Hentz here, and welcome to another edition of Eye on Oshkosh. You know, we've been hearing a lot in the news lately about gay marriage and transgender issues, transgender people, especially in terms of when we think about Caitlyn Jenner. And but it's maybe confusing for a lot of people. I know some of the issues are for me as well. So here to help us sort of navigate through these murky waters and get a better understanding for things, we've got some folks from the LGBTQ Resource Center, which is over at UW-Oshkosh. It's on the campus there. And to my right is Dr. Liz Cannon. She's the director of the LGBTQ Resource Center. And to my left is, we've got two Matthews here, so this might be confusing. They agreed to let us call one Matthew and one Matt, so we're going to do that. Immediately to my left is Matthew Reinhardt. He's the program coordinator for the Resource Center, and Matthew Liefke, who has graciously said we can call him Matt. So that's what we'll do. Matt is a student worker, and he's a former intern at the Resource Center. And so welcome to all of you for being here tonight. We appreciate it very, very much. And they do have a website, by the way, that we'll be putting up throughout the show. But it's uwosh.edu and then /LGBTQ Center. And again, we'll have that up throughout the hour. So I think the best place to probably start, folks, is to talk about the center. How did it come about? Why did it come about? And, you know, just give us a history of it.
Well, I've been on campus for 18 years now. And the second year I was there, the student organization, which is called Rainbow Alliance for Hope, became recognized by the university. And I was their first advisor. And so even that early on, conversations about a possible center started. But it wasn't until 2008 that we saw any movement on bringing a center to campus. And it was one of those things where a positive came out of a negative. We were going into an atmosphere where they were voting on to change the Constitution in Wisconsin and to define marriage as between a man and a woman. And the amount of harassment on campus increased. A lot of times when there is a political issue, we see a lot of reaction on campus. And not only were our students being harassed, but our faculty and staff were as well. And so at that point, the administration said, we need to change climate on this campus. This is not acceptable. And they created, based on a proposal that our LGBTQ council put forward, they decided to create the LGBTQ Resource Center. And I was lucky enough to be hired as our first director. I was interim for 6 years, and now I'm the permanent director.
Excellent.
Of the center.
Well, congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you.
And so, and the center has just recently moved. So currently you are at where?
The physical address is 717 West Irving.
Okay.
We are in what is referred to as the Campus Center for Equity and Diversity, which used to be the former Newman Center on campus. I believe that The university purchased the building back in the 90s sometime.
It's been around for a long time.
Yeah.
I'm a townie, so.
Ah, okay.
So it's I know exactly where it is. It's right on the corner of Irving and
Elmwood.
Yeah. I always have to think about that. Elmwood, and then Algoma goes the other way, and so, but okay.
Yeah.
So, and that's where you actually have your offices, is at that location.
And we always have, because the old center was in the same building.
Oh, okay.
It was just put into what at the time was a closet.
Okay.
It was a big closet.
No pun intended,
right? It was a big closet.
Yes.
A big closet, but...
But a closet.
Okay. So what are your office hours? Let's get that out on the table right off the bat.
Well, we have exciting news. So starting in September, we're going to actually be extending hours. So our new hours starting the beginning of September will be Monday through Friday, 9 to 5. But on Thursdays, we're going to be actually staying open until 9 in the evening.
Okay.
So 9 to 9 on Thursdays.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And what's the reason for the extension on Thursdays? I mean, is there some particular reason, or?
Well, mostly because of a lot of feedback. We had, last semester, back in the spring, we did call out for opinions, and we were doing strategic planning. And we met with students, and we're getting their feedback. And one of the recurring feedback that we were getting from them is they wanted evening hours, they wanted extended hours. Normally we were just doing the 9 to 5, but students that were in class until 4 o'clock or so couldn't get over to the center.
Sure.
So they wanted something to do in the evening. If they didn't feel comfortable or didn't want to go back to the residence hall or their home, they wanted to have a safe place to hang out and congregate.
Okay.
And so we're going to be doing that starting in September until Thursday at 9.
Sure. And this show, we're taping this on the 27th of August, but it'll first start airing on cable access here in the area next week, Tuesday, which is the 1st of September.
Yeah.
But it will be uploaded to YouTube prior to that. So just kind of keep that in mind as far as, you know, the dating and so forth goes. So who do you serve? You're a campus-based organization, but I would assume that you serve anyone in the community, or is this just a campus organization for people on campus?
It is to serve anyone in the community. And we do a series of educational programs, and community members are always welcome to come. Depending on the program depends on which community members actually show up or not. But that's one thing I really wanted to stress tonight, was that our programs are open to anyone in the community, and our center is there for anyone in the community.
Okay.
Anyone can use our resources.
And when you say resources, what kind of resources do you have? I know in looking at your website, there's a library there that you have.
Yes.
And what kinds of material would someone find in your resource library?
Well, we have quite a large fiction section. Several years ago, we had a wonderful couple that were moving out, and they donated their in huge, huge fiction section. So we have quite a large section, and we also have a nice and robust nonfiction section that is growing. We just added over 50 items to it this past semester. Other resources include, we have DVDs, we have magazines and brochures. Another generous person, just this past summer donated a whole box or boxes of magazines of The Advocate and some other magazines going back to 1992. So it's really kind of fascinating to kind of flip through the pages and see not only how much the community and how much the magazine itself has changed, but to look back and say, like when Ellen DeGeneres came out in 1993, like that was on every magazine, much like Caitlyn Jenner, we're seeing that kind of representation. So it's really kind of interesting to see that historical. So that's kind of our print and hard copy resources. You mentioned our online resources. We also have our human resources. So we actually have students like Matthew here. We have Liz and myself, and we also have other student interns. We're kind of our ambassadors on campus and help us do what we do.
So as a student intern, what kinds of things do you do in relation to what Liz and Matthew do? Yeah.
So Liz talked about the events that we have going throughout the semester. The interns help with the events, promoting them, making sure everything's ready the night of the event. usually each intern gets one event or maybe two events to do. So they basically take charge. They can make posters. They can have to help keep spreading the word for it. And with that, then we have projects that we do. So each person gets a project for the whole semester. Like my project was working on the website, making sure it was up to date and relevant. But other projects are working with the library, making sure everyone on campus feels comfortable, making sure they have resources available, stuff like that.
Okay.
And what Matthew won't tell you is the new website he completely designed.
Very good.
Yes. I was on there today and just kind of poking around. I didn't have as much time to look at it as I would like or that I will do in the future. But it's a nice looking site. Now, is it complete or will you be adding more things?
I think we'll always add more stuff when stuff needs to be added. It's always a continuing process, but for right now it's complete.
Yeah, well, good, good. Yeah, nice job. And do you have that kind of training, or did you just kind of learn as you went?
My major in school is computer science.
You knew what you were doing. Very good. So the resources that are there, if I come in and I want to say I want to check out a book or something, do I actually check it out, like at a library, or do I just... Do you just look at it there, or how does that work?
Both, actually.
Okay.
So we have ample seating for if folks want to come by and just find a comfy chair to sit and read for a while. Maybe they're taking a break between appointments or something like that. We have a lot of students who come in and visit, or faculty who have a morning class and then an afternoon class, but they don't want to go all the way back to home, you know, so they'll hang out on campus. Or we can check them out. We actually have just started circulating things electronically. So we can just take your information and check things out to you.
Okay.
And then we're not quite as formal as other libraries.
Sure.
You can't check things out online or renew them, but you can give us a call and we can make that happen
sure.
for you.
Okay, yeah. Good. There's a will, there's a way, right?
Absolutely.
So let's talk about what other things you guys do. Say there's someone out in the community and they're struggling with their sexual orientation or how they identify themselves. You know, I know that you're not a counseling center per se, but if they call, can you point them in the right direction? Can you provide resources to them in that way?
Yes.
I'm seeing heads shaking.
Yeah. Well, yeah. My only hesitation is I'm not a townie, so I'm still learning about all the different resources out here. We also sadly lost a large resource last December when Harmony Cafe in Appleton closed.
Right.
That was a really wonderful kind of go-to place for people here in the Fox Valley. But to answer your question, yes, we can recommend if we know about support groups in the area, or if, for example, even though Harmony Cafe closed, their support groups do carry on. They just had to find a new place to meet. So there was a period where they were still kind of trying to find their place and everything. But we can point people in those proper directions.
And the reality is, we're a referral place, so if somebody's looking for, say, a counselor, we may not, at the moment they call, have a name for them, but we can find out.
Sure, okay.
We have enough contacts both in the city and on campus to make recommendations.
Harmony Cafe, I try to stay kind of up on a lot of these things, and I guess I wasn't aware that they had closed. They were the ones who were operating out of the Goodwill Center in Appleton, right? Or Menasha, I guess technically it was. So where are they meeting then now?
Well, some of the groups, like the LGBTQ partnership, I think that's not exactly their name, but they are meeting, I believe, out of Menasha now.
I think so.
They're still, like, we can go online. They have a Facebook presence, so you can find their information there. Again, that's kind of what was difficult about them is because they kind of scattered to the winds wherever they could find a place to land. And we wish them well. And we actually had a lot of students who had the means to be able to get up to Harmony Cafe, had to kind of figure out themselves. So it was sure. hard, but
mm-hmm. You know, it's interesting. I mean, we have come so far, and yet not nearly far enough. Mm-hmm. You know, in our individual journeys and our journey as a community. When I first moved back to town, I had moved away for a while, and then when I came back in 93, I know that there was a small, very grassroots organization on campus called the 10% Society. Mm-hmm. And, you know, but that didn't really, I mean, I tried to kind of keep tabs on them, mm-hmm. and I went to a few of their meetings, but it really was geared more toward students.
Yeah.
And I think, and I'm not sure on this, maybe you have some information on it, Liz, but it seemed to me like it just sort of faded away after a while.
Well, what happened, it was interesting because it was a group that did not want to be recognized by the university. There was no trust there with what was happening on campus. And to the extent where they wouldn't even publicize where their meetings were going to be. If you were part of the group, they had sort of like a call tree. And they would tell you where the next meeting. I just found this out. I thought that was. But that actually group, the students in 97, made the decision that they wanted to be recognized by the university because they wanted funds.
Sure.
They wanted to be able to bring speakers to campus to do things. And so a good portion of them became the group that Matthew is now co-president of, which is Rainbow Alliance for Hope.
Okay.
And so they did sort of disband, mm-hmm. and they became this new entity that is really student-based and student-focused.
So Rainbow Alliance for Hope is pretty much a student thing, and it's a part of the Resource Center, sort of.
They're separate.
They're separate.
They're separate entities. Okay. We have really good, I co-advise the group. So we've got really good relations, but they are separate entities.
Okay, all right. So you're funded by the campus then?
Yes.
And do you, as a resource center, receive funding from the campus?
We do. We're in academic affairs.
Okay.
And so our funding comes through the Division of Academic Support of Inclusive Excellence, which is in basically academic affairs in the provost office. So that's where our funding
A lot of information
comes.
There, isn't there?
Yeah.
But I'm assuming, and correct me if I'm wrong, I'm assuming that both organizations would and do accept donations from people off campus.
If
yes. Like I've made a donation privately as a citizen to the Resource Center. Is it possible to make one also to Rainbow Alliance for Hope? Or are you strictly... Does your funding strictly come from the university?
Nope, we do accept donations.
So I should have brought my checkbook. You're telling me, right? So, okay, very good. And
can I put in a plug?
Absolutely, sure.
Matthew included a donate button on our website, just in case anybody
That's
feels like
thing.
Donating.
And do you accept checks? I guess that would be if you're mailing it in, but
right.
Do you accept on the website all credit cards and like PayPal, or what's accepted online?
Matthew would know.
Excellent question. We're still in the infancy when it comes to electronic payment. Our credit card donations made through credit card go through our University Foundation, which is a 501c3. So it's not as if PayPal or some other Amazon where you can just punch in your number and it deducts. It's necessary to fill out a form and mail it, unfortunately. But it's my understanding that that's going to be changing soon. However, you can make through a donation and you can get that tax write-off. Mm-hmm. Or you can mail the check directly to us.
Okay.
We also take pennies, you know. We did a penny drive once where actually raised quite a bit of money.
Those pennies add up.
They do add up. Very heavy.
Yeah, they do. And cans, you can always turn in cans for dollars and, and cents, too.
Yeah.
Okay, so I want to talk about, before the show ends, for sure, I want to talk about the various events that you guys have coming up and so forth. But let's talk about some more meaty-type issues. I mentioned in the opening about Caitlyn Jenner. You know, this whole transgender issue is confusing, I think, for most people. And I find myself being a little bit dumbfounded by it. And I know that no one here can speak for Caitlin. But I look at this particular situation and I say, okay, when Caitlin was Bruce Jenner, he was married to a woman, had children. Now he has become a woman and is Caitlyn Jenner, but she has said in her interviews that she's attracted to women. Does that now make her a lesbian then? Do you see what I mean? It's very, trying to just navigate through that is mind-boggling to me. And so I can only imagine what it's like for someone who is just kind of beginning to hear about these words and understand about sexual orientation and gender identity and that kind of thing. How would you all explain this? And Liz, maybe this is a better question for you. How would you explain it to someone? Take that particular situation. And again, I know that, you know, unless you've secretly talk to Caitlin that I don't know about. You can't speak for her, but, you know, it is confusing.
Yeah. I think the first thing to remember is that every single person has a sex, which is what their body is. It has to do with biology. It has to do with hormones. It has to do with chromosomes. And everybody has a gender, which is how they perceive themselves or how they are in their head in connection to this question of how we operate in the world according to gender. And everybody has a sexuality. And that the three things do not align the way we've always been taught they align. I mean, we're taught that females are women, heterosexual. We're taught that males are men, heterosexual. And the reality is there is not an alignment between the three. And so there are a lot of people who are assigned male at birth, like Caitlin. And yet her gender is woman, is feminine. And the reality is, for her whole life, that's what her gender has been. Because of societal pressures, discrimination, she hasn't been able to acknowledge that.
Okay, so let me make sure I have that part straight before we go further. I want to make sure I'm still not confused. So her sex is male.
Her sex assigned at birth was male.
Right. Her gender was female.
Well, that's a sex term. So when we talk about gender, we use terms like what gender expression, femininity, or woman. Okay. So her gender, she was a woman.
Okay. Gender was a woman. Sex assigned at birth was male. Okay. She has not yet, according to what I have read, gone through with the full process for a sex change. So technically, the anatomy is still male, I guess. Okay. So then, I just know that there's people out there saying, okay, then what about the cross-dressers, the transvestites, and transsexuals? Help us navigate that, Liz, because I can see people scratching their heads, and we could sit here for hours, couldn't
we? Yes, we could.
We could, and we do. I think one thing to remember is that transgender is an umbrella term, and it has to do with whether there is a cross, because trans means to cross, from that
sex you were assigned at birth to what your gender is. There's a lot of ways that people who experience that cross express it in the world.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the ways is that they want to change their entire body so that it then aligns.
Mm-hmm.
The term we used to use for that was someone who was transsexual.
Okay.
But life is not as simple as one would ever think.
Right.
And so the reality is that at this point, there are people who identify as transsexual, but may not have any operations.
Okay.
A lot of times they will do hormone replacement therapy.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes it's because the operations are so expensive and most of our insurance don't cover it.
Right, right.
Now, a lot of people who do change parts of their bodies and take hormones no longer use the term transsexual.
Mm-hmm.
And they may simply identify as transgender, maybe a trans man, a trans woman.
Okay.
But the other thing to remember is that not all people actually cross completely over and are sort of what we call one of the two binary genders.
Such as Chaz Bono. There was a partial surgery done.
But I think he still identifies as a trans man, so his gender crossed over.
Okay.
But he, for various choices, did only part of the transition.
Boy,
okay.
I'm so confused now.
I know.
I am so confused. You know, and I'm one of these people who I really truly want to understand.
Yes.
So that, A, I don't misspeak.
Yes.
B, I don't make a fool of myself.
Mm-hmm.
And C, I can make people just in general feel more comfortable.
Yeah.
Within their own skin and about who they are. So if I'm sitting here now, and you've done a good job explaining it, but I'm still scratching my head saying, what?
Yeah.
So is there like a course out there that someone like me can take, or are there reading materials in your resource center that help explain this?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay.
Yes. We've got a lot of materials in the center on transgender. We do a couple of different kinds of trainings. One of them is our general training about LGBTQ. We call it a safe training.
Okay.
And we talk about this in that training. We're also developing an actual transgender training because you're absolutely right. This is the one that people have the least amount of knowledge
right.
about.
Right. And it's the thing that we're hearing more about.
Yes, it is.
You know, and I don't know if it started necessarily with Chaz Bono. Certainly it's been, you know, multiplied tenfold or a hundredfold with Caitlyn Jenner.
Yeah.
But, you know, I just think we all need to be more enlightened.
Mm-hmm.
If you
yes.
don't agree with it, you don't understand it, that's fine. Then just say nothing.
Yeah.
You know, it goes back to the old thing that we were all taught as kids. If you can't say something nice, then just say nothing.
Yeah.
Some of the things that I have seen online are just, well, I'm sure you've all seen them too.
Yeah.
They're just horrible.
Yeah.
And they're so demeaning to a person. And and I'm not just talking about this particular situation with Caitlin. You know, maybe some of the people are just mad because, once again, a Kardashian is being thrown in our face, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But then some of the other comments are just flat out mean, spirited.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And there's just no reason for that.
Mm-hmm.
Because somewhere, sometime down the line, those people may find themselves in a situation where they have a friend, a family member, a coworker who is kind of in a similar situation.
Yeah.
And then you're going to be face to face with it. And you better understand how to deal with it because you can't just run from things in your life.
Right.
And so I would be interested, I guess, in learning more about this. And so when you talk about transvestites, now that's something totally different, and that's just a male dressing up as a female, correct? Or am I screwed up on that too?
Because
I feel really messed up right now.
It's an older term for someone who is a cross-dresser.
Okay.
And it's interesting because in Britain it's still used, transvestite, but in the U.S. it's really not.
So most people who identify as a cross-dresser. And usually people who are cross-dressers don't do it 100% of the time.
Mm-hmm.
But it is presenting as the gender that wasn't assigned to you at birth.
Okay.
Okay. And it is true, most of the people we know who identify as cross-dressers are males.
Okay,
and present.
So the
but not
the
all.
More preferred term now is cross-dresser, not
right.
transvestite.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Well, that's probably good because you get too many trans this, trans that in there, and then I think that adds to the confusion.
That's true.
You know, so this is using a different terminology is probably a good thing. And that is more they're cross-dressing to get a sexual.
No.
No?
It's usually not sexual.
Really?
Yeah. It's usually because there really is a part of themselves that identifies as that or at that gender, and so it's a way to express that part.
Without going further.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Hmm.
Right.
Okay. Now, see, that's different from what I've heard all my life.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So that's, I'll have to put that in my brain, too, for future reference.
I just want to kind of go back to your original premise about like that your confusion mm-hmm. around Caitlin and then and this guessing about, well, what does this mean? What does this mean? It's just easy to let that person tell you, allow them to self-identify,
mm-hmm.
and then that's it. Ultimately, it's not really up to us and what we think and what we care about or what
right.
our opinions are. It's about how that person is in that moment
mm-hmm.
and just acknowledging it and respecting it
mm-hmm.
And respecting them for who they are
mm-hmm.
and just let that be. I really don't need to know or care to know, or it's none of my business, honestly, who Caitlin is in love with or
mm-hmm.
with whom she has a romantic or affectionate bonds. It's her life. I respect her. I care. I call her by the name she uses and the pronouns she
mm-hmm.
uses,
mm-hmm.
And that's all that matters to me.
Yeah. So. Well, and I guess it should to anyone too. The reason I think so many people are curious
mm-hmm.
is because we're trying to understand.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You
mm-hmm.
know, we're
mm-hmm.
trying to put it in some form that makes sense to us.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
You know, anyone who has watched Bruce Jenner for all these years has seen, you know, the athlete, seen the father, seen the husband, and all of a sudden now we're seeing something completely different and trying to make sense of it all.
Mm-hmm.
And so if we had some of those answers, I think maybe it would be better understood.
Mm-hmm.
And yet, I don't know, maybe it would make us more confused.
And maybe, but and as she's telling, sharing more and more of her story, and we're learning more about her history, understand, as Liz had mentioned, all these times that she did identify as a woman, she was a woman, however, because of society's restrictions,
mm-hmm.
that it was necessary for her to live a life as another gender,
sure.
mm-hmm. Or this presentation or the expression. I mean, we hear these stories, these titillating stories about, you know, oh, when you know, she's in her, she was wearing a brassiere under, you know, during press releases and things like that, because that was something that made her feel comfortable. And I think we get caught up in a lot of times this sensationalism, but that was something that was comfortable for her, that it was a tool, perhaps.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I don't
mm-hmm.
know her inner. But I like to think that she's always been a woman,
mm-hmm.
you know, but it's just the way that how she chose or had to
mm-hmm.
express herself.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Because society mm-hmm. makes us do a lot of things that we may not necessarily want to do
mm-hmm.
or be comfortable with doing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know,
mm-hmm.
I mean, the same has been true for years mm-hmm. with gay and lesbian people,
mm-hmm.
you know, having to change pronouns. You talk about pronouns,
right.
having to change pronouns.
Yep.
Yeah.
You know, when you're talking at work the next, on a Monday, about what happened that past weekend,
mm-hmm.
If you're a woman with a woman, well, then you're changing the pronoun she to he,
yep.
mm-hmm.
Just to feel more accepted and to be more accepted. And so.
Or you don't get to talk about your personal life.
Right.
Because
right.
you don't know.
Yeah. So, I mean, I think we all can relate to a situation where we've done something, no matter what your sexuality is, you know, done something to feel more fit in, you know. Even if it's like you're talking with people at work and several of them are sports fans, but you're really not, but you want to fit in, so you pretend to be a sports fanatic. You know, we all want to fit in.
Yeah.
That's the bottom line.
Yeah.
And so we do what we feel we need to do in order to fit in. Okay, I'm not going to try to delve any further into the Caitlyn Jenner situation because I fear that I'll just get more confused than I already am. So let's talk about the acronym LGBTQ. I know what it stands for, but why don't we explain for the viewing audience what those letters mean?
So L is for lesbian, G is for gay, B is for bisexual, T is for transgender, and then Q is for queer.
Okay. Now there's the word. I told you I was going to talk about this. That word I just find so offensive, and I think many people do, and I can hear people out there saying, now wait a minute, the gay people have said for years they don't like being called queer, and now here they're calling themselves queer. So what is this all about? Why is that kind of a more socially acceptable word now than it used to be? Or is it? Is it still socially unacceptable?
All right. I'm the one that teaches queer theory, so.
Okay, queer theory, okay.
I think to always remember is context. Mm-hmm. If somebody says something to me and it's meant to hurt me and it's nasty, it's never okay, no matter what word they use. And this is one of those words that has been used to hurt us for a very, very long time. Mm-hmm. The reality is queer is a word, it's a good word in the English language, and it simply means something that is not the norm.
Okay.
And if you don't think that the norm has to be what is uplifted and what is the best, it's just, this is what, we have a majority here, and then we have something that's not the norm. Mm-hmm. And we don't want to say one is better than the other, it's just the way it is. So when we talk about queer, we're talking about things that don't fit what we tend to talk about when we talk about heteronormativity. I'm going to throw another big word out here. But this is cool. If you Google, do an image search for heteronormativity, you'll get Disney couples popping up.
Heteronormativity.
Okay. And it's what it really is, it's that story that we all have grown up with. Mm-hmm. That story that we're told that we're born, we are either a boy or a girl, which means that, you know, our sex is female and we're going to be women, our sex is male, we're going to be men, and we're heterosexual. And we grow up, we start dating, and we don't have sex until we get married, we get married, we have children. And this is sort of, it's sort of that story. And
it's
there's
a fairy tale type story.
And there's a lot of people that story fits, and that's wonderful. But there are a lot of us who that story doesn't fit.
Right.
And so when you talk about queer, it's that at any point of that story, when you experience something differently, it can be queer. So if when you were born, you were not male or female, you were intersex, you queer sex.
Okay.
When it comes to gender, if you don't have a gender that aligns, then you're queering gender.
Okay.
With sexuality, if you're not heterosexual, and there's a lot of different sexualities, you're queer. You're queering sexuality. You can even queer monogamy, and a lot of people are polyamorous.
Mm-hmm.
And so in that sense, it becomes a useful word.
Sure.
The other reason it's useful is when we say LGBTQ, we have left out a lot of letters, and there are a lot of people within our community who don't get a letter.
Mm-hmm.
And who's to say that one letter is better than another, and who gets to be a letter in the acronym? So if we can talk about the queer community, we don't leave out those of us within that community. So in that sense, it becomes a useful term in that way, too.
Okay, now that part I'm confused on. You had me, Liz, up until there. And now you've thrown me again. Okay, so try to explain that second part that
okay.
you just said
okay.
in maybe a different way.
It becomes what we call sort of an umbrella term
okay.
that can be a way to identify our community and say there are a lot of people in this community, not just people who are lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender.
Mm-hmm.
There are a lot of other people. But in that acronym, they didn't get a letter. But it doesn't mean that somebody who is, say, bisexual is, you know, more important than somebody who is asexual.
Mm-hmm.
And so, because we don't want to sit there and list the whole alphabet soup.
Now it
see?
Makes sense.
Mm-hmm. We can just
got it.
Call about the queer community.
Okay. And now, that having been explained to me like that, I guess I'm feeling less offended by the word.
Right. Mm-hmm. Now, it doesn't mean that everybody has to use it.
Right, no. right.
Because you only want to use it when you're comfortable.
Mm-hmm.
And you will know when people are using it in a very respectful way.
Sure,
and,
yeah.
And some people do use it as their identity.
Mm-hmm.
That no, they don't use any other identity. They just use queer. Others, like, I identify as bisexual and queer. And I usually use both because a lot of times when I think about how I am politically, you know, the ways in which I disrupt or see the world disrupting what we just talked about as heteronormativity,
mm-hmm.
that sort of is my queer side.
Okay.
The reason I still identify as bisexual, though, is because for so many years, bisexuality has been invisible.
Mm-hmm.
And so a lot of times, as someone who is female and who identifies as a woman, if I say I'm queer, people are going to assume I'm lesbian.
Mm-hmm.
And so to make sure that, and you can't even look at my partner and know what my sexuality is.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And so for that reason, I still identify as bisexual, but I will also identify as queer.
Okay, all right. Okay, whew. I feel like I've been in class all day, but this is a good thing. This is a very mm-hmm. good thing. So let's, now that we've got the Q part of it figured out, let's talk about, I was looking on the website about the LGBTQ Resource Center's mission and vision statement, and, you know, some of this is really good stuff. So let's talk about this. Let's talk about the mission statement, first of all. And I think it's pretty straightforward. It just says the mission of the UW of Wisconsin-Oshkosh LGBTQ Resource Center is to create a safe, inclusive, and affirming campus climate for students, faculty, and staff of all genders and sexualities through education, advocacy, and support. Okay, so that, though, now, see, now I just, when I read that, that doesn't say anything about the public, the general public. It just talks about the students, faculty, and staff. So did I miss something there? Or, because it does, you said, this, your center is for the general community, right?
It is. I mean, we are a university entity.
Okay.
And so our, you know, our main purpose is to serve those on campus.
Okay.
But we also serve the entire community.
Okay.
Yeah.
So then let's talk about the vision, because there are six values that kind of are incorporated into the vision. And, you know, who wants to talk about these values?
I'd be happy to.
Okay.
Yes. So, unfortunately, I do not have them memorized, so I'm going to read off your cheat sheet.
Sure.
So the values, six values are equity, community, inclusion, leadership, learning, and respect. So I don't know. I when I think equity, you know, when we promote equity for all, and here we use queer, all queer individuals,
mm-hmm.
And recognizing everyone in the community, and regardless of your sexuality or lack thereof, your gender or lack
mm-hmm.
thereof, socioeconomic status, your abilities, your age, and so we talk about equity, and then I have to check your
That's
list
okay.
again. So community is that sense of community to which we belong.
Mm-hmm.
So whether it's you know, the queer community, whether it's the community of your sorority, fraternity, the group to which you belong, your coworkers, the community in your family, your neighborhood, your city, you know, like, are you a community of Packers? Are you a community, you know, of the Midwest kind of thing? So, you know, that's how it depends how you look at it. And we all kind of have these, I mean, this Venn diagram of these little intersections and these little identities that we all have, and they all kind of overlap. And when we find someone else who really fits with that or has a lot of similarity, similar likes and intersections, you know, we kind of tend to get along. I'm sorry, maybe explain.
I get it. And, you know, and when we think about communities, I mean, you know, we've got, all right, Oshkosh is a community, but within that community, we have many smaller communities. You know, one of my greatest passions is pets, animals, and so I'm involved in many different dog rescue groups, and so that's a community that I belong to. I belong to my church community. I'm a member of the gay and lesbian communities. So, you know, those are, and at some point, maybe those all connect. You did a little cheer when I mentioned about pets, so I'm assuming you're a pet owner.
I am.
So there's another way that our communities are kind of intersecting, as Matthew said.
Yeah.
So, okay, and I don't know, I think we're probably getting close on time here. We probably have about 15 minutes or so left. And I want to be certain that I'm addressing, I think I've probably addressed most of the questions here. One thing, though, that I did notice on your website was a reference to gender-neutral bathrooms. Now, that's a small thing, and I don't want to spend a lot of time on it, but for someone who is a transgender person, it could be a very big thing.
Oh, it's huge.
It is huge.
So how many gender-neutral bathrooms do you have on campus?
Do you remember?
Just approximately.
About 24.
Okay.
Like that.
Yeah.
All right. And what has there been any kind of pushback on that from anyone? Has there been anyone who is upset by something like that?
Not that it's told us.
Okay.
that they are in existence.
What was cool, it was a student who put forth a proposal to have these restrooms on our campus, and it had to be approved by various governing bodies.
Okay.
So it had to be approved by our classified staff, our professional and instructional staff, and our faculty.
Okay.
And all three groups approved them before it could then go into existence.
Okay.
And so with that, we had incredible university and administration support for it. I think one of the things that's important to remember, one is, how important it is. Before them, we would have students that, you know, they would go to the bathroom at home. They'd be on campus all day long and not feel safe to go to the bathroom until they got back home at night. And so the importance of them is there. I think one of the things that we have to remember, though, is it's the bathroom. Anybody can use it. And it's important that all of us use it so it suddenly doesn't become, oh, that's the place that you can find the transgender people.
Okay.
In a very pejorative type, scary way.
Yeah.
And so it's very important that everybody uses it. It's just, and it's interesting because in Europe, public restrooms are rarely designated.
They're all
women.
Just sort of unisex, aren't they?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And I know in our homes we don't have... Although that's a little bit different thing because we know these people in our home intimately,
but still.
It's still... I mean, you know, it's we could learn a lot from looking at Europe. Just in their approach to so many things. You mentioned SAFE, and I did see something on your website about SAFE training. So let's talk just a little bit about that. And I want to get Matt in here talking
about... And Matthew is a SAFE trainer, so I will let him talk
about
it.
Okay, there we
go. So the SAFE training is a three-hour-long program that we hold to build better allies.
Okay.
We do things like go through definitions explaining what gay, lesbian, bisexual, transgender is, go through all the cross-dresser and stuff like that, We also do a thing called Coming Out Stars, where each person will bring in a new identity that they hold. So someone could become gay for that part of the program, and then they will have different coming out experiences to show what it's actually like to come out.
Okay.
Because coming out is never a one-time thing. It always happens. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then at the end, we always have a panel of students come in so people can ask questions and get an actual response from people who actually identify in the community.
Okay.
And it's a huge thing on campus. Faculty and staff who do it get a triangle that they can place up to show that they are allies and respectful for the community. And we've started to do faculty, staff, and also departments.
Okay. Mm-hmm. How often do you hold those training sessions?
4 to 5 times a semester. We have ones that are actually allowed for staff and students to participate, but then if a department or something wants to have their own, they can contact the center and get one.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And are they free?
Yes.
They are. Okay. But they're just for people on campus.
There, some of us who have been doing the trainings for a long time have gone out to the community to do trainings.
Okay.
So, for example, we've done a training at West High School, at
Webster Stanley
okay. Middle School, a couple of the sort of counseling centers around. Okay. Now, the reality is when we go out in the community, we do charge.
Okay. I was going to say,
because
I can't imagine that you're doing that for free.
Yeah. Yeah.
Resources only go so far.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. And so, like, what is the, and I'm sure the charge is dependent upon the group and that kind of thing, but, like, what's a range that you would charge for something like that? Because I think that, you know, this is something that a lot of organizations probably need.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I would say that, you know, at this point we're thinking about how to reach out to the community more.
Okay.
And I'm still in conversations with others to determine costs.
Okay.
So I don't want to overstep.
Sure.
At that
well,
point.
I think, you know, Liz, when you're at that point, I'd like you to contact me.
Yes.
So that we can maybe do this again.
Would love to.
And talk more about the types of training programs that are offered, because I really do think that that's something that, whether you're a city government or a school district or whatever,
yes.
I think it's something that everybody is going to need, especially as we start hearing more and more about transgender issues and what have you. So, okay, we're running out of time. So let's talk about some of these events that you guys have coming up.
Mm-hmm.
I know you had wanted to touch on a couple of things in particular. You've got a major speaker coming up in the fall by the name of Pat Griffin. You want to tell us about that?
Absolutely. So Pat Griffin is a former basketball coach.
Okay.
She is a professor emerita at Amherst in Massachusetts. So she's coming to talk about LGBTQ culture in sports and athletics. Her talk will be about changing the game. That's the phrase she's using it.
That's a catchy phrase.
Yeah, as a lesbian, she has been part of this. She's been changing the game from the inside. So she's coming to do a public speech talk on Wednesday, September 30th at 7 p.m. in the Albee Gymnasium, the Albee Pool and Hall. There on campus, and it's a free event. Anybody can come and join us. During her visit, she'll also be meeting one-on-one with the head of athletics, and she'll be meeting with some coaches and teams and talking about the culture inside. I mean, when we think about people like Michael Sam, you know, when he came out last year, we've also had another, since then, we've had another handful of athletes around the world who are choosing to live open and honestly, and this is part of that conversation.
Okay. Well, I'm glad that you told me the date, because it was not in my information here.
Mm-hmm.
So Wednesday, September 30th,
yes.
It's free.
Mm-hmm.
It's at 7 p.m. in the Albee Gymnasium.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Parking. I know on campus parking is always an issue. So for events like this, for example, that one, is there enough parking to accommodate people, or
I hope so.
Okay,
we'll be contacting parking and asking. A lot of times they will say, "Okay, if there's a big event, there'll be a parking lot and people can park there."
Okay, mm-hmm.
So
right.
We'll be contacting parking.
You've also got an event coming up related to Harvey Milk.
Mm-hmm.
Who wants to tell us about that?
Well, this is kind of, as a program coordinator, it's kind of my wheelhouse. So Harvey Milk will actually be in May. We're going to be doing it the 23rd of May, I believe it is, in 2016. So it's our annual fundraiser. We do this to help raise funds for our scholarship. So, which goes out to students here at UW-Oshkosh, and also seniors in the local Fox Valley High School. So, if they're going to be attending UW-Oshkosh, they could apply for it. We have silent auction. We usually have we have speakers. It's a wonderful evening to kind of wrap up the calendar year. And, okay. And recognize the work and the activism that Harvey Milk created.
Okay. And you have also started an LGBTQ, I've done so well up to this point, LGBTQ plus community group. Meets once a month at a local coffee shop, mm-hmm. and it's called OUT, which stands for Out Uniting Together. Mm-hmm. Where are the meetings? Who are they held for? And how often you meet? Once a month. Does it change from place to place? Are you at a different coffee shop every month, or?
We're usually at the same coffee shop.
Okay. Which is where?
We usually go to Planet Perk.
Okay.
And they have been wonderful, and because we do it after hours. Okay. And they stay open, have barristers there for us.
Yeah. Oh, okay, that's great.
Incredibly supportive.
Ken and his staff are amazing.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so what time is it then that you have these?
We've been asked by the group not to announce that over the air, so if they contact us, we would definitely give them the information.
Okay, fair enough. Okay, and then there is an LGBTQ Studies Certificate Program, which you coordinate.
I do.
So,
and Matthew's one of the students.
Okay, so tell us briefly about that.
We have majors and minors at the university, but this is the first certificate, so it's not as many credits as a major or minor. It's 15 credits. Okay. You take an intro to LGBTQ studies course, and then you do 4 electives.
Okay.
And the cool thing about a certificate is that you can register as a special student and only do the certificate.
Okay.
We've got a couple of people in the community who have been doing that. Some who, you know, have a full-time job, and yet they realize they want this expertise with their job, mm-hmm. and so have come back for the certificate.
Okay. And you can find that at the University of Wisconsin Oshkosh's website. So I'm being told we are out of time. So, God, there's still so much more to cover. But I think for our first time, we did a pretty good job of covering the various bases. And hopefully you folks out there aren't as confused as I am. I'm less confused now than when I started. So if you are too, then we're in good shape. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
To both the Matthews and to Liz. We appreciate it. And thanks to the crew and, as always, to you folks at home or watching on your computer on YouTube. We will see you next time. Until then, take care. Keep your eye on us. We've got our eye on Oshkosh.